Welcome, this is nWARE, and today I'm going to show you how to create the basic launcher for your game in Godot 3.4. Its purpose should be to verify if all data is downloaded, and if not, download the missing files and install them. It also should update the game if a new version is available. This tutorial is aimed at beginners and standard users, not mono users, though the concepts may apply. Okay, let's start by opening Godot. You can create a new project by clicking New Project and then giving your project a name. I'm just going to call mine Game Launcher. Then create a new folder and choose OpenGL 3.0. Create your project. Once you load it into the editor, you can create a new user interface by clicking the green circle. And then I'm just going to rename mine Launcher. Then I add a panel as a background, and I'm going to rename it to background, and then setting the anchor to full rectangle. Now I'm adding another node called a margin container. I'm also anchoring it to the full rectangle. In the inspector, you can find theme overrides and then constants. There you can adjust your margins. I prefer 32 horizontally and 16 vertically. Next up, I'm going to add another node called the VBox container. It orders all its children underneath each other. Then I'm going to add a texture rectangle, which is going to be the logo of our launcher. I'm also adding a panel, but we'll come to that later. First of all, we need a graphics editing software to create our logo. I'm just going to use paint.net. And I'm fast forwarding the installation process if you're interested, but you can use any graphics software you want. In the background, you can see me creating a logo for my launcher. If you're interested, I use the dimensions 800 by 200. Now I'm going to import the logo for my launcher into Godot by just dragging and dropping it into the resource menu. And I'm going to put it in a newly created images folder, which will hold all my images from now on. Rename the texture rect to logo and drag and drop the logo.png file to the texture in the inspector. For the stretch mode, select Keep Aspect Centered. Under Size Flags, select Expand under the Vertical tab. Select the panel and also select Vertical Expand for the size flags. As you fiddle around with the stretch ratio, you see up to a certain point it works just fine, but then nothing happens. And this is because we didn't check Expand on the texture rect. Now it works correctly. Under the Theme Overrides tab, you find Styles, and for the panel, we can create a new Stylebox flat. We can use this to adjust the color. I'm just going to choose a darker gray. We can do the same thing for the background, also a new Stylebox flat, and just darken the color. Next up, we're going to need a game logo, and you can see me just straight up ripping off a Half-Life screenshot and putting some text over it. But it gets the job done. Now just drag the file into your images folder in your project. Now let's create a new margin container and setting its anchor to full rect. Under theme overrides and constants, you can adjust your margins as you like. I chose 32 for all sides. Now I add a HBox container which orders all its children next to each other. And once again, set both size flags to expand. Add another texture rect. This will be our game logo. Drag our game logo into the inspector. And click expand. For the stretch mode, select keep aspect covered. And as always, for the size flags, both to expand. Now select the HBox container and add another VBox container. Select it and set the alignment to center. And the size flags, as always, expand, expand. Small correction, click on the texture rect and for the stretch mode, select keep aspect centered. Then select the VBox container and add a label to it. This will be our game description. Select the VBox container once again and add a button. This will be our download button. In the inspector for the text property and enter something like download now. And then on the VBox container and theme overrides, set the separation to something like 64. Now select the HBox container again and set its separation to something like 32. 64 looks a bit weird. And now for the button, under rect, set the Y value for minimum size to 32 or 64. Now press Ctrl S on your keyboard and save the scene. I just simply call mine Launcher. Now select the button and then attach a script and call it something like gamelaunch.gd. Remove all those unnecessary comments and begin by adding three variables, the exe link, the PCK link and the version link. I will be using the free version of OneDrive for these links and I'm going to show you how you can create direct download links using a little trick in OneDrive. So first, sign up for free. And for this, you need a Microsoft account. After you go through your account creation and click again on the OneDrive Windows link, you can set up your OneDrive folder. You can delete everything in it. And I'm just going to create a new folder called My Launcher. And in it, I'm going to create another folder called My Game. And into this folder, we're going to place our .exe and .pck file of our game and wait for them to upload. In the meanwhile, we're going to create a new file called version. And into it, we're going to put a zero. If you change this number to something higher, the game will update. Now left click your first of the three files and click share. Then click on the small arrow and change to can view. Then copy the link. It is very important to repeat this step for all three files. After you're done, right click and click view online. After the page is loaded, it may start a download, which you can cancel immediately. Now we want to create our three direct download links. For the first one, click on embed and then generate. Then copy the code into a new notepad file. Now select your next file and repeat the steps. Do this for all three. Once you're done, isolate the link by removing everything before and after the quotation marks. The last step for your three direct download links is to replace embed with download. Now copy the links and put them into their three corresponding variables in your Godot project. Now we're going to need three new variables. The exe path, the PCK path, and the version path. These are the paths where the files are stored on our PC. Then create another variable, HTTP request. In the ready function, disable the button so that we can't click it while we update. Create another function, file exists, with one argument of type string. It will return a boolean. Create a directory variable and return the directory's file exists function with the given argument. We need another function, verify game files, where we check if the game files are complete. To do this, we need to call the function file exists for all three and check if they exist. And if they do, we look if there's an update available. If they're incomplete, we need to download the missing files, but we will do this in another function. Now create the actual function to download a file. It needs a download link as a string, a path as a string, and a boolean to check whether we just want to download the version or a normal file. We set our HTTP request variable to a new HTTP request and add it to our scene. Then we set the button's text to downloading and the file path. After that, we connect the request completed signal to another function we will create in a minute, install file, and provide it with the path and our boolean variable, just version. And then we do some error handling. We get the error and then see if it is okay. And if it's not, the button will display the download error. Now we'll create the function that is called once the request is complete. The function is named install file and it takes a bunch of arguments, so it's best if you just look in the video. We don't even need most of them, but we need them all in this order to pass our own arguments, path and just version. Then we check if just version is true, and if it is, we are just going to compare the versions. And if not, we're removing the old file and then creating a new file, open it, and storing all the data we got from the HTTP request in it. Now we need a function that goes through all the files to check if they are missing, and if they do, it downloads them. This function is always called when a file was installed, so that it's called over and over again until all files are downloaded and available. And when they are, we change the button text to start game and enable the button so that we can click it again. Lastly, in our install file function, we add the call to our new check integrity function. We also need to do this in our verify game files function. Now we just need a function to compare the current version to the online version, and if the online version is newer, we need to update the game. We do this by just removing the version file and then checking the integrity, and this automatically downloads the new version file and the new PCK file. Now select our button. Beside the inspector there is a note tab, and there we can connect the pressed signal to onButtonPressed function. Before we go on with this, we just create a new function, startGame, then we use the OS shell open function, and then get our current data directory and append our executable file name. Ensure that you're not missing the forward slash. Now we can go back to our onButtonPressed function and just call startGame. Don't forget to call our compareVersion function in our installFile function and pass to it the new version variable. Now head to our verifyGameFiles function and add a call to download file, passing our version link and the version path and setting just version to true. Now right click on your launcher scene and set as main scene. And then you can run the game to see nothing, because we forgot the most important thing. In our ready function, we need to call verifyGameFiles. And now our launcher should work. If you're interested in where the game files are saved, press Windows key R, type % appdata %, press OK. Go into Godot, app user data, game launcher, and then there is your game. Let's test if the integrity check works and just delete the PCK data and relaunch. And it's downloading the PCK. And now we can start the game again. To update your game, simply head to your OneDrive folder and then drag and drop your new version of the game in and increment your version in the version.txt file. The next time you open up the launcher, it magically detects and downloads the new PCK file along with the new version file. Then you can start the game again and play the new version. The launcher we created was pretty basic, but you can use the concepts to create your own more advanced launcher. This launcher, for example, updates itself while the video is playing. Then you get to pick a username and the username is automatically passed to every game you play. As you can see here, I also added a progress bar to make it a bit more clear how much data there is left to download. And then I can play my game. If enough people request it, I can also make a tutorial for the advanced launcher in the future. And if you have any requests, leave a comment in the description. I hope my first ever YouTube tutorial was acceptable to you all. If you found this tutorial useful, like this video to show your interest. And if you want to see more upcoming tutorials, subscribe to the nWARE YouTube channel. And if you feel really generous, consider supporting nWARE on Patreon, link in the description. But this is it for today. Good luck with your development project. I bet you're doing great. Thank you all so much for watching. See you in the next video.